Welcome into this month's edition of the BSC Sports Show. I'm Landrum Roberts. On this month's edition, we'll sit down with head volleyball coach Jeff White and take a look back at the month of September. Then later on, we catch up with head football coach Eddie Garfinkle and break down the first four games of 2015. All of that and more coming your way next, right here on the BSC Sports Show. Samir gets away from one man. He's got his first down. Samir inside the 10, 5, leaps across the goal line. Touchdown, Panthers. Fakes the handoff, pitch, the ball's fumbled. The BSC Sports Show is being brought to you by Alabama Power, always on. America's First Federal Credit Union, refreshingly unbank-like. Chick-fil-A in Fultondale, home of the original chicken sandwich. Dreamland Barbecue, ain't nothing like them nowhere. The Greater Birmingham Convention and Visitors Bureau. Express Oil Change and Tire Engineers. If we don't take care of our customers, someone else will. Limbaugh Toyota, home of the lifetime powertrain warranty. Pepsi, out of the blue. Piggly Wiggly, we'll see you at the pig. St. Vincent's Health System, care you can believe in. And by Summit Express Urgent Care, at the summit of urgent care. We are now being joined by Birmingham-Southern College head volleyball coach Jeff White. And coach, we have not officially introduced you here on the Hilltop. Of course, you took over in 2014, a great first year, 24-11. Yeah. You're a West Coast guy.
Yes.
You graduated from Cal State Northridge.
Yes.
First of all, how did you get to the South?
Interesting question. I was kind of between jobs. I was working at Westlake High School, and they were kind of losing their attendance, so I had to look for a new job somewhere. And my brother's a pilot for Delta, and he was working in Atlanta, and he said, come visit me. So I went out there and got a job while I was visiting him in 4 days. So I went back to California, got all my stuff, and drove across the country with my parents with a truck.
So I'm guessing that growing up, you played a lot of volleyball out there on the West mm-hmm. Coast, mm-hmm. Sand volleyball, indoor, yes. Did it all?
Yes. I was really a basketball guy, mainly. But in my free time, in the summers and stuff, I'd go down to the beach. Same beaches where Karch Karai played and all that stuff. It was just sort of pickup games, and it really wasn't a huge deal in the mid-80s, TV-wise and all that. So I just played it for fun. And indoor, we didn't have a boys volleyball team indoor, so I just played when I could and played against guys that later on, when I was a senior in high school, those guys got scholarships to college because we implemented a boys volleyball team the year after I graduated, which was a big bummer. But then in college, I played intramurals and had a great time with it. But Cal State Northridge was ranked in the top 25 in the country, and I didn't have the coaching yet to be able to play with them. But I probably could have. But it was great growing up in Southern California. It's kind of a lifestyle out there.
I know you as Coach White. Some people know you as Dr. White.
Yes.
You got your PhD, kinesiology, University of Georgia.
Yes.
So teaching, very important to you.
Absolutely. I mean, my mother was a teacher for 30 years. She instilled in me the importance of education. I didn't get my advanced degrees right after college. I waited 10 years to get my master's and another 10 years to get my PhD. So I had 20 years of, you know, hands-on experience in the field. So now that I have a PhD in coaching, I feel like I have the experience and I have the educational background to really, you know, show my athletes, especially at a school like BSC, where education is so important. I can say education is important, but they know that it's important to me because I got a PhD, and I played sports, and I coached sports. So I hope to be a good role model for them.
excellent high school coaching career over mm-hmm. in Georgia at Northview High School. Mm-hmm. Three-time state champions there, mm-hmm. and you were also named three-time Georgia Coach of the Year. Yes. Of course, the AJC honored you a couple of other years as well. You were instrumental in the 18 and under, the 16 and under.
Right.
Just talk about your success in Georgia at the high school ranks.
Well, actually, I started at Chattahoochee High School, and we went to the state finals my last year there before I went to Northview. We also went to the state semifinals with Chattahoochee. So I've coached in either a state semifinal or a state championship in, I believe, seven of the 10 years I coached in Georgia.
Wow.
We were in a great pocket for kids that played club volleyball. The parents had the means to allow their kids to play volleyball because it's so expensive. But basically, we had a great group of kids, administrators, parents who just bought in and wanted to be the best. And interestingly enough, in Northview, we started that school in 2002 and we won our first state championship in 2005. So it was only the fourth year of the school that we won a state championship, and then we won 3 in 4 years. And it was just a really great experience.
So after all of those years at the high school level, all of the success that you had, you move on to Brunel University,
yes.
an NAIA school. Did you just need a new challenge?
I did. I mean, it sounds really terrible, but I wanted something new. I won 3 state championships in 4 years, and I'm the kind of person that's never satisfied. So I was like, well, let me try and do this on the college level. And that's when I decided to go get my PhD. I thought maybe I'm either going to coach at the college level, or I'm going to teach at the college level, or both. So I went back to get my PhD, and while I was getting that, I was coaching at Brunel. And they offered me the job there, and it's 30 minutes from my house, so I could swing both. I was driving an hour and a half each way to UGA, and I was driving 30 minutes to Brunel. And in the 2 years there, we had more wins in 2 years than they had in the previous 10 years. We had 6 all-conference players, but more importantly, we had academic all-conference players. Almost all my players were there. So I got really good experience coaching at a really small women's college, and it was great for those 2 years.
Talk about getting here to BSC, to the Hilltop. Did Athletics Director Joe Dean Jr., did he make a phone call? Did you inquire about the job? How'd you get here?
Basically, I was coaching club for a long time, and one of the guys that I coached club with also was the head coach at Oglethorpe. And he had just resigned from that job to become an administrator at Oglethorpe. And he called me up, and he's kind of an inside info guy. And he said, hey, man, I heard that Judy Green's stepping down. This is like a day after she put it on Twitter, and it wasn't posted anywhere or anything. He said, that's a school that could win a national championship with the right coach. And he said, I think you're the right guy. But I know Joe Dean, and he's a fast mover. So he's going to hire somebody before he puts this on the internet. And so I sent him an email immediately, and within 45 minutes, Joe responded back and said, we want to interview you. And that was on a Monday, and I had an interview that Thursday, the 12th of December. And I'll never forget it because Friday morning, the 13th, he offered me the job December 13th of 13.
See, 13 can be lucky.
12-13-13 is the date that he offered me the job, and I was like, of course.
And you officially started your role here, I guess, January 3rd of 2014, something like that.
A couple weeks later.
All right, Coach, I want to talk about your senior class. Let's start with Lauren Bedford, your libero. She surpassed the 1,000 dig mark in 2014. Great to have her back for her senior season.
Absolutely. She's an incredible leader. She's one of our captains this year. She, in my opinion, is the best libero in the conference, if not one of the best liberos in the country. She makes incredible plays and keeps us in rallies that we probably should lose. Her digging is incredible. Like you said, she got 1,000 digs last year. This past week, she had one match with 32 digs, which is only one away from cracking the top 10 all time here at our school. She is up for Player of the Week this week. She also is the only player this year in the SAA ranked in the top 5 in aces per set, digs per set, and total digs. So that's pretty incredible because, you know, liberos can be either good at digging or serving, but she's top 5 in both, which is pretty incredible.
Your other seniors on this year's squad.
Katie McCormick is our leader out there. She's a setter. She's a captain as well. She has worked so hard. She was actually recruited as a middle hitter, and she has turned herself into a setter. Last year, she was the setter of the year in our conference. She's on pace for that again. She's number 1 in the conference in assists per set. But the intangibles that she has are incredible. She's just a great leader. They all listen to her. She runs a show. She's like a field general out there. It's just great to have her.
And, of course, Emily Dang.
Emily Dang's our backup setter. But when she came in, she was recruited as a setter, and they ran a two-setter offense. Unfortunately, we're running a one-setter offense now, but I know that if anything ever happened to Katie, we'd be in great hands. Emily is a great, she's almost a second coach out there. She stands on the sidelines, but she's watching. She's always giving Katie information. She's just a supportive, great senior.
Last but not least, Molly Peavy.
Yeah, Molly Peavy is, she's just a feel-good story. She's had a couple rough times, but this year she's coming out. She's starting as a right-side hitter. She's just one of those ones that everybody just hopes that she just has great matches, you know. And she had a couple great matches this week to help us go 3-0 this week.
Your juniors.
Yes.
And both of them in the middle. They're your middle blockers.
They're a big middle.
And they are a big middle. You have Caroline Hyde and LVP, as you call her, Laura Van Persum.
Yeah, I don't know if it's Pearsum or Pearsum. Anyway, so we call her LVP. She's 6'1", middle, out of Randolph High School. She's we call her the Great Wall of Laura because she just blocks incredibly well. She runs a slide very well, so she scores. She's a good combination of scoring and blocking. Caroline's actually one of the top five in blocking in the SAA this year. But she's a little undersized for a middle hitter. She's only 5'10", but she's a great leaper. But Caroline's our superstar student. She's a 4.0 athlete. She's all-American in academics, and she's a really good player for us.
And she has so much fun. We can see her in between sets as the music's playing. She's singing, dancing. She has a good time out there.
She is a great person.
And it's quite obvious with all of your players, they enjoy playing for you. A lot of team chemistry.
Yes.
And I guess as we get away from the roster for just a second, all of the long bus trips that you have to take in Division III, and you just did those, you're going to get close being together all that time.
We are. In fact, yesterday we were on a bus for 6 hours together from Center in Danville, Kentucky. And they were playing cards, they were playing Uno, we watched this wasn't to my liking, but we watched High School Musical, and apparently they know every single song in that entire movie. So that was just a big musical for 2 hours on the bus. But yes, they've all gotten to know each other, and so they don't sit on the bus by class. They'll, you know, freshmen talking to seniors and so on. So, and at the hotels too, they watch movies together. They've really had a good time, and we went on our two long bus trips the last two weekends. So we're ready. We have some home stands coming up. And I think we're ready to win.
Let's talk about the rest of your roster now in the sophomore class.
Sophomore class, we have three sophomores. We have Riley Seagrass, who this year, she was actually recruited as a setter, but she's now a defensive specialist and a passer. So imagine going from just using your hands to using your forearms all the time. It's a really big transition there. But she's made it, and she's starting for us in the back row. Rachel Lee was also recruited as a setter, but we're transitioning her to a defensive specialist because of the seniors that we had as setter. She's a great server. She gets a lot of aces and puts the other team out of system, so that really helps us. And Chloe Ballard, unfortunately for her, she had labrum surgery in the offseason, but she's a big 6'2 blocker that we're hoping will come back and help us out in the future.
Very talented freshman class that you brought in.
Yes.
A couple coming from up in North Alabama, Bob Jones High School.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Geneva Salter, she's actually leading the conference right now in kills and kills per set as a freshman, and it's not even close. Even though we've had less matches than other teams, by three or four, she still leads the conference in total kills, which is almost impossible. Saturday, in a match at Swanee, she had 32 kills. Yesterday at Center, she had 24 kills. So she had 56 kills in 2 days, which is, most people don't know stats with volleyball, but that's a lot.
That's a lot. And she was nicknamed in high school by her current teammate and former teammate from Bob Jones, the Hammer.
Yes, Milena Hissam, she named her the Hammer. Milena's doing great too. Milena's a DS for us. It's funny when they stand together because Geneva's 6'1" and Milena's 5'1".
Yeah.
So and they're like friends, and they've known each other, and they play club together. So Milena's, it's the tall and the short of it. Milena serves and digs balls so great because obviously her center of gravity is low, and she does a great job in the back row for us.
Coach, lots of big matches this past month of September. I want to talk about two of them specifically. 17th-ranked Barry comes in to Bill Battle Coliseum right here on this very floor, and you absolutely dominated that night. Talk about your team's performance.
Well, I think we watched a lot of film, and we kind of figured out where their weaknesses were, who could score for them, who couldn't. Their middle's an All-American. We decided we were going to stop her. There was one of their passers we felt like didn't pass as well as the others, and then they played that person. So we just served. We have very accurate serving. It's one of our strengths. So we kept serving that same girl. And unfortunately, when your best player is a middle and the passing isn't good, you can't run the middle. It's one of those things. So we decided we were going to try to take her out of the game, and we did. And it was actually, it wasn't an easy win because Barry's tough, but it was a convincing win.
And then you had a, I think, Wednesday night tilt against Millsaps as the majors came in.
Yeah, I mean, we were, last year they were one of the top three teams. They lost a lot of seniors this year, so their experience is low. They didn't have as good of a freshman recruiting class as we did, so we took care of them pretty well.
You're assisted by Ashley Veach. Mm-hmm. She played a little volleyball in her day.
Yeah, she played for me, actually, in high school at Northview High School. She won three state championships, all three that I won as a coach. She won as a player. She was state player of the year her senior year. I've actually known her since she was 9 years old. Her older sister played for me at Chattahoochee, and when we were in the state championship, I remember Ashley was, again, like 9 years old, and I was peppering with her, you know? And so I thought, I was thinking, reminiscing the other day about, wow, I was playing around with a little girl, 9 years old, coaching her older sister, and 15 years later, here I am coaching college with her. I never would have believed that.
That's amazing.
It is. It is.
Talk about what you envision for Birmingham Southern as the head coach, the direction of the program. Where do you see the program going in the next 5 years under your leadership?
Well, we want to win a national championship. We know what it takes to win a national championship. Emory down the road has been to the national championship match several times. They've won a national championship. They've been runner-up two or three times. So it's easy to have a barometer of what you need to do. If you can beat them, you can be a national champion. That's kind of the way it goes. We have not beat them recently, but this year, first match of the year with a bunch of freshmen. The first set, we took them 25-23. We were ahead 23-21, and we had every chance in the world to beat them. And I think with our recruiting class coming in 2016, I really think in the next couple of years, we'll have a very good shot.
Finally, Coach, big month coming up of volleyball for you and your team.
Yes. We have some big matches coming up. It's the second half of conference play. We finished first half 6-1, so we're hoping to duplicate that. Last year, the conference champion was 12-2, so if we can do that, we hope to win the conference championship and host the conference tournament.
All right. Well, best of luck. We enjoy watching your team play, and go Panthers.
Yeah, go Panthers.
All right. That's head coach of Birmingham Southern Volleyball, Mr. Jeff White. When we come back, we sit down with Panther head football coach Eddie Garfinkle as the BSC Sports Show continues after this. Landrum Roberts now being joined by Birmingham Southern head football coach Eddie Garfinkle right here on the BSC Sports Show. Coach, first of all, we're going to recap the first month of the season, the month of September. You got off to the quick start this year traveling to LaGrange. You head over to Georgia for your season opener. What an exciting game.
Yeah, it really was. You know, of course, this team here is a young team, and we didn't really know what we had. And, of course, going in at halftime down 21-3, I was concerned and really didn't know how we'd respond. So, you know, our guys showed a lot of resilience and coming back and finishing that game. That's one thing that we, you know, didn't do a year ago, that they were kind of the theme this year is to finish. So it was a good start to the season for sure.
Well, you mentioned trailing 21-3 at the half. You come out and really said a lot about your team and the halftime adjustments. 13 points there in the third quarter really set the tone for that second half of football.
Right. You know, I mean, basically, we had our opportunities early, and we just didn't take advantage of it. Offensively, we sputtered and threw an interception in the end zone and that type of thing. And then the guys just came back and regrouped. And defensively, you know, we've got 10 new starters on defense. And Sid Gotell, the only guy that started was a nickel, and now he's a corner. So we're all new on both sides of the ball. So we've got a good young team. They play hard, and they've been fun to coach so far.
You were trailing late, 2:42 to go, when Kerrigan Pennington intercepted a pass. It was a pick six, took it 37 yards back for the touchdown. And I really think that that set the tone really for the next week when you played Huntington as being, I called you the cardiac kids.
Right.
Just always coming up with a play at an opportune time.
Yeah. Well, and again, I think we needed that win for having a young team and having confidence. They bought into everything we were kind of telling them. And so, you know, I mean, it was exciting. KP executed the call excellent. And the thing that kind of, you know, stands out really is we had a kickoff with 2-something left and completely dominated them the rest of the game. And And so we finished the game. We finished the game, and I definitely think that gave us confidence for the next game against Huntington.
So the Panthers defeat LaGrange 29-28, payback for last year's overtime loss right here. Then the next week, Huntington, the battle for the Wesley Cup, 6 o'clock. That's become a tradition, a 6 o'clock kick for the home opener here at Panther Stadium. Great crowd as always, and it was great because I can't remember Huntington playing here in several years. It seems like we're always going to Montgomery, but Huntington brought a lot of folks, and it was an electric atmosphere.
Yeah, it was. I mean, you know, our Panther Stadium has got a great setting, and especially at night when it's completely full, standing room only, and all that. Of course, I'm kind of oblivious to it, but I know our players can feel the energy and that type of thing, so... Again, our guys played hard, and we just found a way to win. And that's all we asked our players to do. And, you know, we made a bunch of mistakes and did some things, but we played a really, really good football team that night and beat a good football team. So that's the bottom line.
I thought a pivotal play was on that opening possession, first offensive possession. A targeting call called against Huntington.
Right.
Extends the drive. You end up marching it down the field, cap it off with a one-yard touchdown run. That was a great start, and really, you never looked back from that point on.
Right. You know, I think, you know, starting the game and scoring and giving some momentum, giving our guys confidence. And like I said, they lost a pretty good player, which was the right call, their starting linebacker. You know, and that probably hurt them a little bit. But, you know, we battled and took a good lead, and then, of course, you know, we responded with the two kickoff returns after they scored, which put our defense back on the field, and that's what happened really in the fourth quarter. Our guys played a bunch of snaps on defense and got tired, and you get tired against a really good offense like Huntington, you know, you're going to give up some plays, and we did.
All right, you mentioned the two kickoff returns. Everybody at Birmingham Southern was introduced to Jamal Watkins on that night. A newcomer, first-year right. player for Birmingham Southern, 92-yard touchdown return on a kickoff and a 93-yard kickoff return for a touchdown. Talk about Jamal and how did Jamal end up here on the Hilltop?
Yeah, well, Jamal this is his third year out of high school, and he went to high school in Georgia with one of our players. And he walked on to Mississippi State, and then the next year transferred to Dodge City Community College and decided he wanted to have an opportunity to play. Didn't have much opportunity and transferred here. Started this summer. He's a great young man, great kid, very smart. And he's just small, but he can fly. And we knew that he had some speed, and we got to continue to get him the ball in all kinds of different ways. And we have been trying to do that the last couple of weeks. But he's a great kid and a good football player.
In the final minute, or the final 53 seconds of that game, 20 points scored between the two teams. In all of your coaching career, have you ever had a final 53 like that?
No, never really had, you know, and it shouldn't have happened because, you know, we gave up some big plays, we had some penalties and all that type of thing. And again, that's a lot had to do with what Huntington did, but that was kind of actually disappointing defensively. We should not have given up a couple of the opportunities that Huntington had.
I'm going to put you on the spot, and don't want to harp on officiating, but there was a jump ball to the end zone. Your right. defensive back seemed to have pretty good coverage, and then all of a sudden he hits the ground. Your thoughts on that play?
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple bad calls on that drive too, and that's just part of it. But yeah, they definitely pushed off, and the official went to grab his flag for whatever reason, didn't throw it. That's part of it.
That's what I was getting at.
That's part of it, right. You know, and look, you can't, you know, that's just part of it. That's gone both ways, and we tell our guys we can't use that as an excuse or anything like that, and that's just part of the game.
Well, it was a big night at Birmingham Southern. Also, new president, Dr. Ed Leonard, he and his family introduced to the home crowd, and what a treat he had to witness that first Wesley Cup game here on that Saturday night.
Yeah, you know, Dr. Leonard came to the LaGrange game, and I didn't know he had come, but was able to talk to him the next week, and he was really, you know, excited about the way our guys played and competed and came back. And so really, that's two games as far as introduction to Birmingham Southern football. And you know, if we compete like that every game, you know, it makes things fun. Whether you win or lose, of course, winning's a lot more fun, but you can live with guys going out and playing their hearts out like our team has done early in the year.
Well, in 14 years of play-by-play, the Huntington game, probably in my top five, is most exciting. So I appreciate that. And we could breathe a little easier when it was finally over and the Panthers got the win. So the following week, we open up Southern Athletic Association play, and it's the Suwanee Tigers, and it's a team for whatever reason we've had trouble with. I don't know if it's the offense, the pace, the time of possession. They keep the ball. Right. They ground it and pound it. A lot of misdirection. But I thought from top to bottom, that game, Coach, was one of the best performances by a Birmingham Southern team, start to finish, that we've had here in a while.
Right. Yeah, there's no – that was – and that was one thing that we've really emphasized, you know – in 2014, we played in spurts, but we never really played as a team. But that was a great team win against Suwanee. There's no doubt about it. You know, defensively, we did a really, really good job against their flex bone. Offensively, we answered when we had to. And so it was a really, really good team win. And we handled – the biggest thing was Suwanee, their offensive line was new. And so we were able to control the line of scrimmage there. Their defense is excellent. They've really improved defensively, just the type of players they have. They have a really good scheme. So we knew it was going to be a battle. But kicking game, offense, defense, we really put together that game.
All right, so a 21-3 win over Suwanee. You're 1-0 in the conference, but you draw a tough opponent the next week, and especially with a young team, their first road trip. You travel to Washington University, WashU, St. Louis. Did you know how your team was going to respond going on the road for that first time?
Well, you know, that's always a concern. Doing this for 30 years, I mean, the first time on a road, especially a long road trip, an eight-hour bus ride, we're, you know, just staying in a hotel. And it was different, and we did not handle it that well. You know, we had a good week of preparation, but something happened, I believe, between Thursday and Saturday, and we kicked off in that 48 hours. And, you know, we're going to have to handle our next road trip a lot better. And if we don't, we'll have a difficult time playing on the road. But we definitely were not the same football team that week as we were our first three games.
Yeah, WashU got off to the quick start. They never looked back. Final score, Washington University 41, Birmingham Southern 13. Well, last week, University of Chicago comes in, a new opponent, as was WashU, to the Southern Athletic Association. A lot of great athletes. Saw these guys play the week before. Very impressive against Center, a team that, you know, it's a good team. And they really had their way with the Colonels, winning that game 39-20. They come here to Panther Stadium. And, man, you guys seem ready to play.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things that our guys did a really good job of bouncing back after a disappointing performance. And, of course, it was a disappointing loss. But we had a good week of practice, and we went out and competed and played hard. And, you know, unfortunately, we made a lot of mistakes and beat ourselves, really. And that's the unfortunate thing that we got to clean up and fix. Or else, you know, you have a hard time winning football games when you have four turnovers and you have penalties, especially going in for scores, and you're giving up big plays, long runs against, you know, good team. So those are things that we got to eliminate. If we eliminate those things, you know, we'd have a good chance to win that football game.
Well, you force a couple of interceptions. They turn the ball over three times. The bad news is BSC turns it over four times, and as you were alluding to, that was really the difference in the game.
Right. You know, we were down 14-7 at halftime and had an opportunity to really gain momentum the first 5 minutes of the third quarter. We got the turnover, the offense got the ball in good field position a couple of times and really never could do anything with it. And, of course, we missed the field goal and then, you know, just never really got the momentum back the rest of the ball game.
Mickey Courtney, who had some time in the first game against LaGrange and then was replaced, comes back. He gets the start last week. Any reason for that? Any rhyme or reason why Mickey got the start?
Yeah, the main reason is because Austin Martin hurt his ankle in practice that week, so he was out for the Chicago game. And, you know, Mickey and Austin, we feel, you know, like we have two good quarterbacks. We have confidence in both of them. And we'll probably have to play both of them the rest of the year. And Coach White and I have talked, and you know, sometimes it's not bad when maybe if a guy comes out and is maybe struggling a little bit somewhat, and we have another guy we feel like can put in, and then the rest of the way, that doesn't mean that the starter is going to stay out the whole game. And that's kind of how we're going to play it by ear, which guy's got the hot hand and can put the ball in the end zone for us.
We saw the newcomer, Jamal Watkins. He emerges last week. Again, two touchdown receptions this time from Mickey Courtney, 57 and 55 yards, had 119 yards and two touchdowns on the day, and that helped out Mickey. He did throw the one pick, but Mickey Courtney, 249 yards passing, you'll take that on any Saturday.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, but we just got to eliminate the interceptions, you know, and we've got to be able to connect with all our receivers. And when people start getting, you know, crowd line scrimmage, ganging up on the run, and we've got to really soften them up, and that's what we've got to do. We've got to do a good job of throwing the deep ball and executing it, taking our shots, and that's got to be a high percentage throw for us. And so we continue to work on that, and you know, make people pay for ganging up on the run.
We know you have to leave here shortly after we finish our business. You get to get on that bus and take a nice bus ride to Conway, Arkansas to take on the Hendricks Warriors. Hendricks, they've been a thorn in our side really the last 2 years, last year especially. High-powered offense, they can do it all, and they, like Chicago, very big up front on the offensive and defensive lines.
Right, yeah, I mean, you know, we've been playing these guys now for 3 years, the same guys, especially on offense. And their offensive line, all five started as freshmen, now they're juniors, they're all 300 pounds, they're really good. And they've got the best quarterback in the conference in Seth Peters, and some really good physical tall receivers that can run, 6'4", 6'5", guys. So they're averaging 45 points a game on offense. We're gonna have to control the ball and keep their offense off the field. And we're gonna have to run the football and score points when we have opportunities to, in order to win the football game. So it's gonna be quite a challenge. And again, it's gonna be another road trip. Hopefully we'll handle it better and play well, because we're gonna have to definitely play well in order to have a chance to beat Hendricks.
Well, best of luck at Hendricks. Birmingham Southern taking on the Warriors tomorrow afternoon, and try to even up their conference mark in the Southern Athletic Association at 2-2. Best of luck, Coach.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Landrum.
Birmingham Southern with a big game tomorrow at Hendricks. You're watching the BSC Sports Show. Well, that's going to do it for this month's edition of the BSC Sports Show. Special thanks to Birmingham Southern College President Dr. Ed Leonard, Athletics Director Joe Dean Jr., and Sports Information Director Sarah Recca. From all of us here on the Hilltop, we'll see you next month. This edition of the BSC Sports Show has been brought to you by Alabama Power, always on, America's First Federal Credit Union, refreshingly unbanked life, Chick-fil-A in Fultondale, home of the original chicken sandwich, Dreamland Barbecue, ain't nothing like them nowhere, the Greater Birmingham Convention and Visitors Bureau, Express Oil Change and Tire Engineers, if we don't take care of our customers, someone else will, Limbaugh Toyota, home of the Lifetime Powertrain Warranty, Pepsi, out of the blue, Piggly Wiggly, we'll see you at the pig, St. Vincent's Health System, care you can believe in, and by Summit Express Urgent Care, at the Summit of Urgent Care.